everybody. What the flick is What the Fright. It is Halloween. Happy Halloween, everybody. We are here with the last episode of our look at some of the best horror movies of the 21st century so far, and we are here with the inimitable Clarke Wolfe.
Oh, thank you. Nice to be here. Thanks for having me. Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween. Oh, my God. We didn't dress up as anything. I'm a muggle.
I'm a nerd.
And sure. We're proud. and we're actually going to be talking about one of the nerdiest horror movies
yes.
ever produced. And it's one that we're really going to have to delve into spoilers. We're just going to warn you right now. It's part of this list. If you haven't seen it yet, you should. You can stop right now. Go see it. Come back. But if you have seen it, join us because we're about to talk about Cabin in the Woods. Let's take it into a clip.
Absolutely. Let's do it. Cabin in the Woods, Joss Whedon, Drew Goddard, Chris Hemsworth. We love them. Angry gods and monsters and all kinds of things. And I just love this movie.
Oh, this is awesome.
Whoa, no way.
Lambs have passed through the gate. They are come to the killing floor.
Let's get this party started!
I seriously believe something weird is going on.
Okay, so Cabin in the Woods had one of the most unfortunate post-production cycles in movie history.
Oy vey.
Like, really bad. And a studio went bankrupt. It got shuffled around. It was being post-converted to 3D. They unconverted it from 3D. Took forever. Chris Hemsworth went from being a nobody to being a star. And then this came out.
Yeah.
And it had already been shot. And the air of mystery about it was really thick.
Mm-hmm.
And then we finally saw it, and, you know, oh, God, well, could it possibly be as good as the hype? Yes! It's one of the best horror movies and certainly one of the best horror comedies I have ever seen. And, again, we're about to get into heavy spoiler territory, so fair enough. It's about a bunch of kids that go to a cabin in the woods. We've seen this movie a million times. But Richard Jenkins and Bradley Whitford are also in an office building somewhere, and they're manipulating the events like the directors of a horror movie, trying to make sure all of these kids die. For it turns out, a human sacrifice.
Yes.
Everything is a ritual. It's not just a genre, it's a ritual, and it needs to exist constantly.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like Wes Craven's New Nightmare.
Mm-hmm.
It serves a valuable function. And with that, we get so much richness. Like it's a commentary on the horror genre. It's a commentary on a society that lets bad things happen for the greater good.
Mm-hmm.
It's a commentary on old people who see children as disposable.
Mm-hmm.
For their own needs, it goes on. Like, where do you even begin?
Yeah, I mean, I truly, truly love this movie, and I'm often baffled by horror fans who really don't like this movie. There are a lot of horror fans out there that I think felt like this movie was attacking the genre.
Mm.
But I think, you know, there's something that we delve into a lot in, I think, internet, you know, and the nerd world and criticisms of the things that we love. I don't think that that's a bad thing. If you love something, it's okay to critique it. It's okay to encourage it to be better.
Yeah.
And Drew Goddard and Joss Whedon said that that's very much, it was their love letter to the horror genre, but also saying, do better.
Yeah.
And I love that. And there are so many Easter eggs in this movie. There are, goes YouTube videos
just
for
the
days.
Whiteboard alone
is a
treasure trove.
But it's made by true fans. Mm. And I feel like that is the key to unlocking this movie. Because somebody who had a cynical outlook or somebody who didn't like horror, who got kind of stuck or assigned to a movie like this, could have made something very, very different. But the fact that these guys are true fans, I think, elevated the material.
Well, I talked about this in the episode where we did Shaun of the Dead, but I feel like a truly great satire works as the thing it satirizes.
Absolutely.
This is a great Cabin in the Woods movie that's also a satire Cabin in the Woods movie, much like Scream is a satire
yes.
of slashers, but it criticizes it a lot, but it's also really, really a great
yep.
slasher. It understands what makes it work. But yeah, I think you got a good point here. I think there's too many people who think that being a fan of something means giving it a free pass.
Absolutely.
And I think that when you're a fan of something, I think that means you love it so much you want to hold it to a high standard. A lot of filmmakers have had this excuse lately, which is we made it for the fans. So you think your fans have low standards?
Right.
Is that you think they'll just forgive you for anything you do? That's not a good defense. Here, they expect you to know the genre. Mm-hmm. They expect you to recognize all the references, and if you do, the whole thing just blooms like a flower.
Yeah, I love that this movie gives their audience credit. This this movie does not talk down to the audience, and this movie expects the audience to rise to the occasion. And I love that. I also love the side players. So I love you've got the kids that go into the cabin of the woods. They are your archetypes, but they of course subvert those archetypes just a little, and making it fun. But the Bradley Whitford and Richard Jenkins, you know, and that whole element of it, like talk office culture and just two schmoes and you know, I think about this all the time. Like, you know, when you go let's use an extreme example. If you go skydiving and the person that you're strapped to, your instructor for the tandem jump, that's a real person. They're probably hungover from the night before. Mm-hmm. They want to go home. But these are real stakes. Like, you're jumping out of an airplane. And so I kind of love that with this, these are guys just working their 9-to-5, doing their office gig, having the office pool. But it's also the fate of the end of the world.
I think it was Drew Goddard who said in the commentary track for this that one of the inspirations was the Manhattan Project, the developing of the nuclear bomb. There were scientists, office workers, whose entire goal was to make the most destructive force in the world and kill millions of people. Yeah. And it was a day job. It had to be, otherwise it wouldn't get done. It's unthinkable.
Yeah.
But that's fascinating, isn't it? I mean, it's certainly fodder. And I think, you know, we talk about it maybe like, you know, maybe it's heavily critical of the horror genre. I think it's heavily critical of everyone. I think it's critical of people who see human beings as fodder. Mm-hmm. The ending of the movie I have a weird relationship with because it's very much damn the world. Mm-hmm. We're young, the world screwed us, screw it all. And I when I first saw it, I cheered. Mm-hmm. And now I feel like that's really irresponsible.
Yeah.
It's a really complicated ending.
We're in a different time as well. I guess what I'm saying is this is a movie that was made by Americans, and this is a movie that features a mostly American cast. But, you know, the idea of, like, our safety and everything is fine, and if you don't know what's going on, you know, you can have those, you can take it to those extremes, you can take it to those risks, you can have, it's almost this, like, really, I don't know, this crazy outlook on life that I feel like is almost exclusively American, and to say, just, you know what, screw it all, whatever. Let's start over.
Let's vote for a third party candidate. Like, it seems like a good idea. Maybe it has consequences.
And so now here we are in a place where, you know, we are let in on the inner working, the scary inner workings of the bigger world around us in real life. That's happening. So I think looking at this ending now, it's a lot less fun.
Yeah. No, I totally agree. And I think that's great that this movie can, even within 10 years, can dramatically evolve and still work.
Absolutely.
Maybe it doesn't read the same way, but, like, you know, the best movies grow up with you. You look at them from a different perspective. And I think the Scream, for example, is another one of those for me where when I was young, I saw it as a slasher, and now I see it as this really just potent feminist allegory for these really toxic men who just attack women because they saw sexuality and it freaked them out and it ruined their stupid lives. We're getting off track, but, like, I just feel like the good ones change.
Absolutely.
With you and stay relevant.
And that's the point of horror. You know, to me, honestly, the point of genre is to talk about the things in a society that scare you, that scare its people, and to use genre as metaphor or allegory. And so, you know, that can change, that, you know, depending on the audience and the eyes that are watching it. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I agree. I think that this is a really special movie. And I just want to real fast mention how incredible Chris Hemsworth is. Because, like, when I interviewed Paul Feig for Ghostbusters, he said of Chris Hemsworth, "God rarely gives with both hands." And this was, for me, probably one of the first times where you see funny Chris Hemsworth. I mean, he is funny, and he plays the jokes. My favorite one is, we should, you know, let's stick together. And then they do 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 do. let's split up. And it's like, but the timing is so great. And he's so handsome. And it's just so unfair. But he's, so I just, like, I love Chris Hemsworth in this movie. And I'm so glad that Drew and Joss grabbed him early.
Yeah, they noticed something right away.
They sure did.
And I gotta say, I also wanna give a shout out to their entire production team and monster effects department.
Oh my God.
Because when this movie goes insane, with like a cavalcade of monsters. I want to see movies with, how has this not had spin-offs? I want to see movies with all of these, but they keep talking about, oh, how do we do with Cabin in the Woods too? You don't do spin-offs with each of the monsters.
Yeah.
I want to see how they got captured. Like, they're so cool.
An
like
anthology.
The Hellraisers are cool, the mermaids are cool, yeah.
An anthology series where your through line are the guys that work in the building.
You're welcome. Yeah. Hollywood, get started.
There you go.
Clark's executive producer.
You're welcome.
That's fine.
You're
I'll be
welcome.
The gaffer. So Cabin in the Woods, what's your rating for Cabin
so,
in the Woods?
So, okay, Cabin in the Woods is, I love this movie. I give it a solid 8.8.
Wow.
I love this movie.
Okay, I'm a little bit more enthusiastic. I'm going to give it a 9.3.
Wow.
I love it to death. I want to, before we go,
yeah.
We've had a lot of people like say, why aren't you covering these movies? We had 15 episodes. We picked them based on, you know, what people wanted to talk about basically that day.
Yeah.
We all love all of these movies. And I want to give a quick shout out to some movies that we didn't get a chance to
sure.
talk about. So like what are some great horror movies of the 21st century that we really get a chance to talk about?
Drag Me to Hell, Sam Raimi's Drag Me to Hell, which we both love.
It's so great. It's, another one's great in the theater.
Absolutely. Oh,
sound
yes.
Sound design is insane.
It's so fun. Audience activity, like audience interaction on that one is so good. And I want to give a heads up to Alex Aja's The Hills Have Eyes.
Oh, really?
I love that movie. I think
more than the original?
Oh, yes. Absolutely. We can have a long conversation about that.
Anytime.
But I love that movie. I think it has a lot to say, and I think it is brilliantly executed.
Okay. I want to give It Follows. I think it's a very original horror movie, and that's hard to do nowadays. Get Out is still my number one favorite movie of the year. The year's not over yet. It might change, but I think it is brilliant, and I hope it gets a bunch of Oscar nominations. I think it's fantastic. Mm. I really wish we could have had time to talk about American Mary, which I think is an absolutely brilliant horror movie that really looks at the genre from a couple of different angles that I think we've never seen before. And if you've never seen that movie, I highly recommend it. And there's a million of
the list goes on and on and on.
Neon Demon is fascinating.
I love Neon Demon.
Holy crap.
You know, It, I love It.
Yeah, we covered it, but like good. It is so good.
Yeah, I'm glad you guys got that one.
Yeah, I mean, we didn't get to Guillermo del Toro like
oh,
at all.
Oh gosh.
The Devil's Backbone, totally. Pan's Labyrinth, even Crimson Peak, I think is really
I love Crimson
it's
Peak.
So
the
good.
Orphanage.
Oh, that's good. J.A. Bayona. Fucking awesome.
Yeah.
So like, we know. There's a
the
ton.
The list goes on and on.
And we would love to cover them all. And who knows? Maybe we'll be able to do something more with this format. And we'll be able to talk to you more about great horror movies in the future. If you want to do that, let us know in the comments. But for now, have a happy and safe Halloween, everybody.
Happy Halloween.
And thanks for joining us.